Good morning, all of you. I am Kapil Kshemkalyani. I am a computer science engineer and I am working in Einstein technology from more than 3 years. I am working on Android platform. So you can say that I breathe Android, I sleep with Android. So we are today here to explain you the basics of the Android. So let us start. Let me give you the brief introduction to our company. Our company is mainly into embedded and mobile products solutions. We have delivered various mobile applications to client, and we are also building some applications for ourselves to launch. We have created an application that actually saves human's life. That is an alarm center application. When user is in trouble, user can raise alarm and he will get help from various resources. And there is another application that we are creating. It will explain you the how Android can be useful in remote areas. In remote areas, it is very hard that to provide the instruments that cost more than 2 or 3 lakhs. To identify or to detect the malaria in the blood sample. So we are creating the Android application that actually processes the blood sample and it detects whether it is a malaria or not. These are the contents that today I am going to explain. What is Android, the history of Android, then Android architecture, then Android building blocks, and Android building process, and then we will have a question answer session. So what is Android? Yeah, it is very general that it is mobile operating system, but it is not 100% true. Yeah, it is operating system, that is, it is a consist of operating system, but it is a whole package it comes with. So in technical terms, we call it as a software stack. And what software stacks comes up with? It comes up with operating system, that is a Linux 2.6. Then it comes with the middleware, that is all the libraries, all APIs. Then there are some key applications like email client, phone, SMS, and all. It comes with that application and also a rich set of APIs. So one more question. So Android is operating system. So is Android Linux? The answer is Android is not Linux. Android is just based on Linux. Android uses Linux kernel 2.6. for its various processes, that is for security, for memory management, for process management, it uses Linux kernel, but it is not Linux. We can say that in Linux there is a native windowing system. We call it X windowing. It is used for networking. So Android does not support that windowing system. Also, Android does not have a glibc support. It is a normal GCC C compiler. Android that doesn't support. And there are other various utilities like GNU Linux utilities that Android does not support. So what Linux provides to Android? So what Linux actually does in Android? It provides the security model. In Linux, it assigns user IDs to every user. And one user cannot access the properties or the data of another user. That security model Android uses, but it is slightly a different context. In Android, every application has a user ID. So every application runs with a different user ID, so that no application can access other application's property. So that security model is from Linux kernel. Also, it provides the memory management like paging and all other algorithms. Process management, process schedulings, then it also provides a network stack, then various drivers it provides. It also abstracts the hardware from upper layer. And as he said, Android has modified or he's introduced some patches into Linux kernel. So what are these? Android has done, main thing is alarm. So in mobile, it is required that after some time or after given time, it will wake up or it will raise an alarm. So after, so that is the alarm that the Android has implemented. that was not presented in original Linux. Also, there is a ASHMEM, that is Android Shared Memory. So, in Android, more than two applications shares the same memory. So, that was not originally present in Linux. And also, Android runs on the devices where power is a crucial thing. And so, it also enhanced the features to save the power, that is the power management techniques it has introduced. Then, also Android runs on a very limited environment, that is there is a low memory, low CPU usage. So, if a certain condition arises where there is a low memory, so in that case, Android kills the application which uses vast resources so that other resources can utilize that and user will have a seamless user experience. And also Android has enhanced or implemented a logger functionality. It is just like a system.println, but it is used for debugging purpose, as you all are aware of Logcat in Android. So, where we can see all logs, that is a logger. We use Android for Android development, we use a Java language. So, my next question, is Android Java? Yes, we all know it is not Java. It just uses Java. It just uses to create a program. It also implements the Java 5 AC specifications. So, what Java 5 has provided, the APIs, then all the features that it have implemented. But it does not uses the Java virtual machine. It uses its own, that is Dalvik virtual machine. It is highly optimized to run on a very low environment, low memory environment. Now, let's take a look at the history of Android. In 2005, Google acquired Android Incorporation, and it the work on the Dalvik virtual machine has begun after that. But 2 years before the Android Incorporation has begun by a group of people who had a mission to create a mobile application or to create a mobile operating system in 2003. And 2005, Google acquires them, and the work has started. Then in 2007, Google announced Open Handset Alliance. It is a group to create an open standard for the mobile platform. And various companies, companies like mobile manufacturers and telecommunication companies have come together to form that group. The examples are the Samsung, LG, or we can say T-Mobile, that all are in the Open Handset Alliance. Then later it is Sony Ericsson and other companies have joined that group. So, in current situation, more than 86 companies are in that group that are working to create open standard. Then, in 2008, T-Mobile announced a G1 mobile. It is Android, and they released SDK 1.0, and it is also released open source. Then, in 2009, Cupcake, that is the SDK 1.5 released. It is the most stable version than the previous version. Previous two versions were beta versions. They named as Apple Pie and Banana Bread. And this is the third one, Cupcake. It comes with the soft keyboard. Then later 1.6, Donut, and 2.0, 2.1, that is the Eclair has released. Then in 2010, Nexus One mobile released to the market, and SDK 2.2, that is a Froyo, released. The main feature addition to the Froyo was USB and Wi-Fi tethering. And later 2.3 Gingerbread were released. The main feature added in the Gingerbread was NFC support, then video calling, etc. Then the latest releases are 4.0, 4.1 ice cream sandwich, and 3.0, 3.1 that is honeycomb. Honeycomb is for tablet PCs or tablet devices. The UI is designed to suit the tablets. This is the current distribution of the Android versions. So we can say that more than 60% is Android 2.3. It is distributed in public, and then Android 2.2. It is near about 40%. So this distribution is important because if you are going to create the applications, then we need to understand the target. So this distribution is very important so that we will not miss users. So this is the Android architecture. There are mainly five components in the Android architecture. The very lower level architecture component is a Linux kernel that we have earlier mentioned. It consists of various drivers. Then the next above layer is libraries. Android provides various libraries for like SQLite, then OpenGL for 3D, 2D. Then there is Android runtime. It consists of various core libraries that Java has provided, and Google has added some Android specific libraries, and there is a Dalvik virtual machine. And the next above layer is application framework. As a developer, this is the most important framework because it provides all the APIs. And the next layer is application, that there all the native applications will reside, and as well as native application, all the third party applications will also reside there. And if we create application, then it will also be in the same layer. So every application is same. If there is some built-in application, so we can replace that application using that framework. So now we will see every component in detail. It is a Linux kernel 2.6. It abstracts the hardware from above layer. It provides, it provides the security, memory, process management, and it also provides various device drivers. That is a display driver, then a camera driver, then a Bluetooth driver, keypad driver, Wi-Fi, whatever drivers that Android device required, it is used from a Linux kernel. Then the next layer is native libraries. Android stack includes various libraries like Surface Manager. Surface Manager is used to draw things on the on screen, like a 3D, or we can or drawing the camera on the screen. Then there is a media framework which is used to play a media components on the device. Then there is also SQLite. It provides a built-in database, but it is not like like Oracle or SQL. It is a lightweight database. It provides limited access, but we can use that to solve our application need. Also, there is a OpenGL support, which we can use to render 2D, 3D objects. Now the next component is Android runtime. This component includes two components, that is the core libraries and Dalvik virtual machine. So what are the core libraries? We use Java for developing Android applications. So we use ArrayList, we use generics, we use classes, interfaces. So it is a Java library. So Android has implemented all the Java features into its as a libraries, and we use that feature to develop our Android application. But it does not, it is not copied as is. Android has changed the features of the Android. So there is no JVM. In general, Java classes get executed on Java virtual machine, but Android has optimized Java virtual machine to run on very low memory or very limited environment, and they have created a Dalvik virtual machine. And here the dot class doesn't run. There is a DEX, that is a Dalvik executable, the finally which runs on the Dalvik virtual machine. So let us understand the what is the exact difference. What is DVM and what is JVM? So it sounds like the same. For a developer perspective, there is no difference. We write Java application, it gets executed on the DVM, and if we write in Android application, it is executed in the DVM. So what is difference? There is architectural difference between them. If you consider DVM is a register based, so, and JVM is a stack based. So what is register based? All the Java classes or the Java code get converted into a assembly language code, and to create assembly language code, Dalvik virtual machine, it use the register as a primary storage, and whereas in DVM it use the stack as a primary storage. And also DVM is highly optimized, then it runs DEX file, whereas in JVM it runs dot class dot jar files. And Google claims that it reduces 30% of instruction set as compared to JVM. So this is a notable thing that Android has done. So what exactly happens in creation of the DEX file? So we write code in Java, then normally it is compiled by the JAVAC tool, Java compiler. So the from dot Java class, it creates dot class file, and it is Java bytecode. But there is another tool, that is a DEX tool, which converts dot class file to the DEX file, and here it changed or he optimized Java bytecode to the Dalvik bytecode, and finally that DEX file get executed on the Dalvik virtual machine. Now this layer is the application framework layer. As I have said, as a developer, every time we get introduced to or get we uses this Android framework, it encourages the component reusability. That is, if I want to create an application, suppose I want to create an application to view a PDF file, then Android, this framework provides me a functionality or to functionality so that other application can also use my application. If there is a requirement to view PDF file, then they also use my application to use in their code. So this is the component reuse. So using that, we can publish, shares our activity, service, data with other applications. And also we can create, we can replace, or we can enhance existing features in the Android. That is, we can replace phone dialer application, email client, etc. So the main components in this framework are activity manager. So what is activity manager? In Android, there is an activity which is a main building block. So activity manager actually manages the activity lifecycle. It also manages the activity stack that we will going to explain in next slide. Window manager and the view system, they controls or they manages what is to be shown on the screen. Also there is a notification manager. You all have seen Android phone, so there is a status bar, we can see a notification on the status bar. So notification manager manages that. Then there is a telephony manager. We using that telephony manager, we can access the underlying telephony stack and telephony hardware using that. Then there is a resource manager. We can use various resources in our application, like any drawables or images, XML files. So using resource manager, we can manage it. There is a location manager. In location based systems, we require a GPS and we use locations. So in that case, a location manager is required. So this is the application framework. So now let us understand, let us see what are the Android building blocks. If we want to create an Android application, we create one or more of these components, that is activities, view, intent, services, notification, content providers. These all components are loosely coupled components and they bound together by using Android manifest.xml file. So if we create any Android application, there is a manifest file, and in manifest file we write or we specify every component that we used in our application. So let us discuss this in detail. So the activity is our application's presentation layer. So what we see in our application is an activity. So we can say that activity has a screen and it processes some, or it has to process something, and typically it corresponds to one UI screen. And in Android, only one activity is visible at a time. So what happens to other activities? So there is a concept of activity stack. If you want to create a activity, we need to write a Java class which extends activity, and we get all the callbacks, that is on create, on resume, that we will see later. We can implement using that. Then there is an intent filter. That intent filter specifies the purpose of the activity, that is what this activity is going to perform, or what is the function of that activity. Let us take an example. If I want to create a activity which captures a image, so the intent filter will specify an action that it will capture image, and it requires a data. The image path that it will store image into its memory card. So any other applications can use that intent and fire the intent, so the my activity will get started using the same message passing mechanism. And for creating activity, we generally activity is a full screen, but we can manage it to we can use it like a dialogue theme or transparent, semi-transparent. So all this functionality is also provided. This is the activity life cycle. Activity has four states. The first is the active state, then there is a inactive, then stopped and paused. Whenever activity is visible and it is focused, it is in active state. If suppose another activity comes up and our activity goes to the foreground, then it can be a paused state or it will be in a stopped state. And if activity is not in an Android stack or activity stack, then it is in inactive state. If we write activity, then we will get all these callbacks. Whenever activity first get created, we get callback to onCreate method. Here we initialize all the UI components and all process we all the threads we need to perform, that we will initialize here. Then after onCreate, there is a callback of onStart. After onStart, our activity will be in a visible state, but we cannot say that it is in active state. It may be in pause state, because onStart it is visible but it is not focused, so user cannot interact with that activity. So when we get a callback of onResume, that is the time where our activity is in an active state, so we can interact with our activity. And the same process in a reverse direction. OnPause, we'll get a callback to OnPause when other activity comes up or our activity goes to foreground, and whenever our activity get destroyed, we get callback to onDestroy, and after onDestroy, it will be erased from activity stack. In Android, if we press a back button, it will finish the activity. So suppose our application is active and I started activity and I press back button, then it will the on destroy will call and it will erase from the activity stack, and my foreground activity, my activity will comes up. Now the second important building block is service. In creating application, we many times comes across a situation where we want to perform a long running applications and long running task, and which does not require a UI, that is download a file or play a music. So what we do, if we do in it in the activity, so what happened if activity get paused? So download will also be paused. So there is service. Using that service, we can implement all the necessary functions. Service don't have UI, so it only used to perform a task in the background, and generally long running task. But suppose service have to show some UI, or that suppose a file is downloading and I want to show through a service that I am downloading. So what service will we do? Because he does not have the UI. In that case, Android has provided a notification manager, that so that service can notify user through a notification manager that something is downloaded. You have seen in the Android market that it downloads the application, then there is a progress dialog in the notification that it shows the percentage. So it is through a service using notification manager. Also, to start a service, there are two forms. We can directly call start service, and mentioning the service name, it will get start, and it will be in the running state until and unless anyone explicitly called stop service, or the service itself called stop self. Until and unless, it will be in a running state. And the another form is a bound. That is, if suppose one there is a music player service, suppose there is a music player service which is playing the music in the background. Now the my activity, it want to show the UI that 30%, that is 2 minutes played, 3 minutes remaining. What my activity will do? It will bound to that service using bind service. So when I say bound to that service, it will gives me a handle, and that is the I binder, and using that I'll access all the service functions, and I can again stop it. Now the next important component is a broadcast receiver. Android system broadcasts various events, like my battery is low, or I have one incoming SMS. So these are the notification for users, so that user can take action. If a battery is low, then it notifies user that you should do something to avoid your power, your battery backup. So in that case, broadcast receiver is used, which actually receives the events and it performs its task. And to use broadcast receiver, we need to write a class that extends the broadcast receiver. And one more thing that we need to do is we need to register that receiver, that it will receive the event by using, we can mention it in the Android manifest file, or in the Java we can register it. And there is we provide the intent, the same intent which has action, which has data. Using that intent, the broadcast receiver comes to know that what actually happened. The next component is content provider. In Android, we can store data, we can create data, and we can share it across the all the applications, and it is possible through a content provider. And it is the only way to share the data across all applications. It is just like normal database. we create a tables, we create all the relational database like columns, then their foreign key, primary key, everything same as that. And the database is exposed through a URI. It is a uniform indicator, uniform resource indicator, and it so that any other application has that URI will access our data, which can modify our data and use it. The example is a contact manager, the contact provider. It is a content provider which allows us to get a mobile contacts, and we can add new contacts, we can edit existing contact. So this is, and we can create our content provider too. So next component is the intent. It is a message passing mechanism. So what is a message passing mechanism? Suppose my activity want to download a particular file, and there are two other applications which have implemented the same. So what I will say, I will create an intent object. I will write a action that download a file, and it will, I'll say a start activity. So what will happen, the Android in the background, it searches for the action, that how many activities or how many components have registered to that performs that activity or that perform that action. So it will show the user that there are two applications that are using the, that can perform the action. So user can select. We normally see in Android, suppose we want to view a image file, there are various image viewers available in our phone. So it shows two, that is our inbuilt gallery or some third party image viewer. So they provides us the two options so that we can select and it will start. So it is by using intent. It starts particular activity or service. It is a runtime binding. The intent object has four primitives that are action, data, component name, and extra. I want to view a image file. So in that case, the action is action view, and the data is my file's URL. So I will publish the intent, and Android will searches how many activities or how many applications had registered to action view. So it will start and it will give that data to that activity, so that this activity will display the file from that data. And component name is, we can directly start the another activity by giving a component name, that is our package name and class name. Android manifest file. Every application contains one manifest file. It has the information about all the necessary components used in the Android. And the components are activity, service, broadcast, receiver, and content provider. And it also specifies the intent filters, that is, we have already seen what operations it is going to perform. Then manifest file also specifies the permissions. If our application uses the Bluetooth or a camera, then we need to provide a permissions that I am going to use this permission. So in manifest file, we write that permissions. And also we need to write a minimum API layer so that application will not get installed to the devices which has a lower API level. Then if you are using any third party libraries like Google Map or something, then we need to explain, we need to specify this is on manifest file. The view is a basic UI building block. In our application, what we see is everything is a view. So we see a button, we see a edit box or any list. Everything is view. View is nothing but a rectangular component. It has properties like it has width, it has height. We can specify manually, or we can assign them a value like fill parent or match match parent wrap content. So it will get automatically assigned value. Then there is the views can respond to events. Like if I click on the event, or if I long press on any view, so I will get a callback. So it is a user interactive. Then there is another concept of view groups. View group is a view, but it has some more things to do. View groups are used for creating a layout managers. In Android, there are various linear layout, relative layout. They generally used for various screen set to the UI will be consistent if we use a layout manager. If you hard code the values, then from for every device the values will differ and it will get UI. So user will not like that. So layout manager we use, and it is organized as a tree. So in view groups we add groups and we specify their alignment. And if the views what Android has provided that not satisfy our need, then we can implement our custom views by extending by writing a class which extends view. In our application there are various various needs that where we need to store a data. So Android provides various techniques by using which we can store data, like share preferences, then file system, then SQLite database. So let us study all in detail. Shared preferences is nothing but a key value storage, a key value pair. And for storing, it allows various all the primitive types like integer, long, string, boolean. We can all store in shared preferences, and this shared preferences also get shared across application if we need, and if we not, it is only limited to your applications. So there is a mode. When we create our shared preferences, we need to specify the mode. When we specify a private mode, it is just limited to our application. And if we specify it is a world readable, then all application can read it, but they cannot modify. And if we write world writable, then anybody can read, anybody can write. Generally, they are used for application specific user settings. Now the next storage is a file storage. In Android, we can write data to internal memory as well as to the external memory. And if we write data to internal memory, it is secure that any application cannot access it. So if the need of our application is to write a secure data that anyone cannot able to modify or read it, then we write into an internal memory. But internal memory is very low, so we need to take care of that. And also we can write into a cache directory. It is also in the internal memory. So if Android is running a low memory, then Android explicitly delete the cache. So that is also we need to take care. And we can write into external memory. So there is no security, nothing constraint provided. So any application can use, read, can do anything on external memory. Generally, we use this for saving like our media files on the external memory. It also provides the SQLite database. It is just like any other database. We create by creating the tables, by creating its columns. We also derives their foreign key, primary key, and it is accessible by its name. And it is, but this database is not accessible to any other application. So it is just application specific, and we can perform all the crude operation, that is create, read, update, delete, or we can fire various queries on that. And but in SQLite, the data types supported are very less compared to other. It just support integer, real, text and blob. If you want to write a boolean, we need to use the integer in that case. and there is no long, so we can use integer for storing the long values. Now when we create any application, this is the structure actually get created. If I created a hello world application, then this is the source folder where this is the source folder where all my activities, all services will get created. Then this is the gen folder that is generated, where only one class will exist, that is r.java. That r.java class is a resource, that is a resource class. There are the IDs of resources that we use here are get stored, just ID, it is just a reference to that resource. And in there is a resource folder. In resource, various resources that we used for building Android application will reside. In animation folder, all the XML files that we used to to perform animation is stored. And in color, there is a color constant gets stored. There is a drawable folder where all the images that we used for Android to develop a UI get stored. And there is a something that is HDPI, LDPI, MDPI. So Android supports various screens. So my mobile is 2 inches and this is a 7 inches tablet. So how we can go, we maintain the consistency in our application. So Android have provided this feature. So it is also a runtime binding. So depend on the mobile density, it will select the images from specific folder. So we can create a set of images, that is a small image, then medium, then high density image, and we can place into every directory so that depending on the device size, it will select at runtime. Also there is a layout file. We create our UI in XML, that is they are all our layout files which resides here, and there is a libs folder. If we use third party libraries like JSON or anything, then it will reside here. We need to give a class path, and then if we want to show the menus in our application, then there is a menu and raw. In raw folder, if you use some audio file or some any video files, that will not compile, it will reside in the raw folder. In values, string constant will get stored. So this is required because if I want to write an application for India, and so the string constant in any Indian language, and suppose now I want to publish that application in Russia, so there is now what will I do? The string constant that I defined is in Indian language, so how is going to take? So Android has provided that resource so that it is in the runtime will detect the local of the device, and it will select the resource depending on that. So if I create two resource file, one is for India, one is for Russia, then depending on that device, it will select which resource file, so the user notification or the all text will be consistent across the world. And finally, this is the Android manifest file that we have already seen. And default property file is just shows the min API version, SDK version. So how application get built? In Android application, there are Java files, there are resources files. So Java files using JavaC gets converted to dot class files, and the resources file get converted by using the AAPT tool, that is a Android asset packaging tool. So it creates the r.java file and resources.arsc file, and then there is a dex tool which converts dot class file to dot dex file, and finally that dex there is a APK builder tool which gets all the resources, all the dex files and compiled resources, uncompiled resources, and it packaged to into one file, that is the APK file. It is just similar like RAR or zip file. And finally if you want to port it on a device, we need to sign it. For a debugging purpose, we sign it using a debug key. It is it will get from the SDK. But if you want to launch that APK on Google Play or Market, we need to sign with our own private key. So Java Key Tool provides all the information how we can sign it. So after signing, our APK is ready to get launched. And one more thing that required to get launched on the market is zip align tool. It will minimize the usage of memory on the actual device. So after all this process, our APK get created and we can port this on a device, and we can use ADB tool, or we can directly download from the market to install on device.